Hey, this is Mark Beaumont. I am an adventure cyclist. I hold the Guinness World Record for the fastest circumnavigation of planet Earth. That's 18,000 miles on a bicycle. And I've done that twice. I'm really proud to be an ambassador for Van Gogh. I've worked with the team there for many years, and I've got to test some of their kit designed for adventure cycling. Now, clearly, that's got to be some of the lightest and toughest on the market. But the purposes of this short video is to introduce you to adventure cycling and how I pack my bike for multi-day trips and even really long single day trips. So there's a lot of excitement right now, people getting into adventure cycling, and the evolution in terms of bikes and how we kit up to go on multi-day rides or even long single day rides has changed so much in the time I've been doing it. It takes a bit of practice to know what to take and what you can leave at home. The classic mistake by everyone that goes on a bikepacking adventure ride first time round is they take too much, or they take things that they never need. And then there's other things that you might not think about, which I would regard as essentials. A setup like this, certainly for adventures closer to home in Scotland and the UK, can go absolutely anywhere. And if I reflect back on the first time I cycled around the world when I was 22, 23 years old, back then adventure cycling was with pannier bags. So having racks out the front and the back, typically having four or five fully laden bags, and you could carry a lot more, but that slows you down. It hugely affects the handling on the bike, and it also compromises your ability to go onto the dirt and the off-road. Whereas a setup like this, very similar to what I took breaking the Africa world record, 6,000 miles, 10,000 kilometers from Cairo to Cape Town. So the only difference really between this setup and the Africa bike was, say, the width of the tires. So I had a straight road setup there, whereas this is more gravel. But in terms of the bags that I've got packed onto the bike, almost identical. And I was out there on my own for 41 days and 41 nights. And okay, we're talking about Africa here, so maybe slightly different temperature ranges than the UK. But I typically had 7.5-8 kilos of kit. And then you've got to think, have I still got room left in my bags to carry food and supplies? So what I thought I would talk through is the setup here of an adventure cycle bike with bike packing setup. So not having the old pannier racks, but everything attached to the handlebars, the frame, and the seat post of the bike. It allows you to go as light as possible while still having everything you need and not compromising on the handling of the bike and your performance as a rider. It allows you to go for multi-day, multi-week trips. But the thing I love most about adventure cycling like this is it's as much about what happens off the bike as on the bike. A bike like this, a gravel setup, can go almost anywhere. It's, you know, perfectly good at riding the roads, the tarmac, but when you hit the gravel trails, or even what I would only used to take on mountain bikes, it's pretty phenomenal. As far as Van Gogh is concerned, the important story all happens up front, because this bag here is the one that you only need to touch once a day. That is what I call my house. So what happens back here is all to do with your food and your supplies as you go, but that your house is in here. At the end of a long hard day cycling, you're gonna want your tent, your sleeping bag, and your sleep roll. And if you're gonna get the recovery you need to then wake up and, you know, ride again tomorrow, then what sits in here is important stuff. I had the opportunity in Patagonia to be one of the first to test the Project Hydrogen, one of the world's lightest tents, using airbeam technology rather than having the tent poles. And to be able to wrap that up in there alongside an incredibly light sleeping bag and insulated sleep roll, air filled, just means you're getting the comfort at the end of a day in the saddle to mean you can wake up fresh and ride again in the morning. In the main frame bag, and these come in different shapes and sizes, you can be putting your food. You can be putting anything. If you've got longer tent poles, if you don't have an airbeam tent, longer poles. You know, if you've got paper maps, which I would still recommend, so you've got backup if your technology fails, then anything which is easy to grab, likely to be your daytime kit, sits in here. Quite often I'll also ride with a small bag that sits on the top of the top tube here, and there you can throw your mobile phone, you know, the basics of you know, your next bar, or you know, some food to keep you going. And so that's the easiest to grab of all. I've not put it on the bike right now. Your saddlebag is your largest space, typically about 18 liters. They come in different sizes, and the cool thing about them is you roll them down. So if you've got less kit, then it's a smaller bag. It's also super useful because it keeps mud and wet from the road from splashing up your back. So I'll sometimes ride with that bag, you know, anyway, just as a bit of a guard on the back of the bike. The only other Vango equipment for end of day recovery is your cook stove and your pans. And because that's a larger item, that will sit with my spare clothing in the saddlebag at the back. And it is super important, especially if you're doing night riding or you're camping out, to have that warm, dry set of clothing to change into. In the back there, you'll also have tools to fix your bike if things go wrong. So you might have your pump, your multi-tool, and the other basics. If you're going on longer trips, you might have a spare tire. If I was going on longer trips where I know I'm going to be away from towns and, you know, bike shops for multiple days. But it's always worth thinking through what could likely go wrong on my trip, and if it does go wrong, can I carry the spares without having to carry, you know, extra weight? So things which often break are, you know, the bolts, the cleats that fit on the bottom of your shoes. Carry some spare bolts, they weigh nothing. You don't need to carry a whole new chain, but you might want to take a magic link, something to repair your chain if it breaks. If you don't want to carry a spare tire, carry a patch or something which can fill a rip if you damage your tire. I'm riding tubeless here, but which allows you to ride at slightly lower pressure, certainly when off-road. But you know, if I am riding with tubes on road, then you know, having spares and patches is the absolute basics. You'll also notice that for a bike packing setup like this, whether you're riding road or gravel, I've got lights on. Now, I've got lights on even if I'm not night riding, because my backlight in particular is something I'll almost always have on in flash mode, even during the day, because whilst you won't need it if you're off-road, if I'm ever on road, certainly through towns, I want that on most of the time. Because then you also need to think, well, because of that safety element and having a rear light on, how am I going to charge that? So for big trips, like the length of Africa or around the world stuff, then people often use front hub dynamos, which will bring a charge point out on the top of your stem here. Or you might decide, look, I'm going to stop at little cafes and places along the way and just charge things with a wall charger. So, you know, your cameras, your phone, your lights, it is worth thinking about how you're going to keep those things charged as you go. And typically, most people these days will also have some sort of a cycle computer device. Now, in order to not drive yourself nuts when you're out adventure riding, you don't want to be staring at your power, your heart rate, your stats all the time. So normally I just ride with it on map mode. So it's I'm a bit old school about these things. I like to have a paper map with me, because if this thing fails, I still need to know what my options are. And also, if you've set a route ahead of time, using Komoot or whatever route mapping technology you use, it doesn't really tell you what's around you. If you get to a place and you think, well, I've picked a route, but I kind of want to know where that goes, then having some old-fashioned sort of paper mapping with you, which I'll always have stuffed in here somewhere, is a good option. So you keep that context to the ride. It's always super exciting towards the end of the day, and you know it's going to be sunset in a few hours, that thought of, right, I need to find somewhere flat, dry, away from houses and away from somewhere I can safely pitch my tent and get a brew on and my evening meal. And that's the exciting thing about adventure cycling. When you start going from being a commuter or somebody who enjoys a weekend cycle with friends to going on adventure cycles, it's as much about what happens off the bike as than what happens on the bike. So whilst cycling and, you know, the well-being from the ride is good fun, you then get to the end of the day and you have the next experience of how am I going to get clean water, get my food, find a safe place to camp. And that's where all your Vango equipment really comes in, because to be able to enjoy tomorrow's ride as much as you enjoyed today, you need to get a good meal in, a good night's sleep, pack it back away, and then repeat.